Secretary, Ministry of Defence, Engineer Karunasena Hettiarachchi, Chief of Defence Staff, Air Chief Marshal Kolitha Gunatilaka, Commander of the Sri Lanka Army, Lieutenant General Krishanta De Silva, Commander of the Sri Lanka Navy, Vice Admiral Ravindra Vijayagunaratna, Commander of the Sri Lanka Air Force, Air Marshal Gagan Bulatsinghala, senior officials of the Government of Sri Lanka, defense advisors, distinguished participants, delegates, ladies and gentlemen. It is an honor to be here today at the invitation of the Commander of the Sri Lanka Army, Lieutenant General Krishanta De Silva, to articulate the concluding remarks of the Colombo Defence Seminar 2016. The Colombo Defence Seminar is an internationally recognized forum for intellectual exchange and discussion on issues of contemporary relevance, particularly related to strategic issues and security nationally, regionally, and internationally. Let me at the outset extend my warm congratulations to the Sri Lanka Army, which has organized and conceptualized the defense seminar for the sixth consecutive year. The professionalism of the Sri Lanka Army and its ability to organize an international event of this magnitude is aptly reflected in the manner in which this seminar has been conducted. As I was reflecting on what I was going to say to you today concerning your deliberations, it dawned on me that my good friend, the Commander of the Sri Lanka Army, has assigned to me perhaps the most unenviable task of this two-day exchange of intellectual and professional firepower, if I may borrow a bit of hard power parlance, from your team. It is perhaps fashionable to have the last word in any temporal affair, but those who volunteer to be the last speaker at events such as these must indeed muster quite lasting power. More so that so many eloquent, thought-provoking ideas, analysis, constructions, and much more have come before mine on almost every conceivable aspect of soft power. I now have the Herculean task of attempting to keep your attention while trying not to bore you with a repetition of what has been said previously. Ladies and gentlemen, the great paradox of the 21st century is that it can either be humanity's terminal century or the threshold century, one that sets course towards a sustainable and humane future for us all. Such is its potential and its pitfalls. The very fact that technology and weapons that could end human civilization exist, and the ideologies that could reignite theories about a clash of civilizations, make this a very unique but troublesome century. It is time for humankind to put in place limits and controls so that the technologies we develop do not end up destroying us and our long-term future. If we are to survive, we must build rules-based arrangements, networks and institutions that enable us to cooperate and flourish on this planet. We are living in transformational times. Global power is transitioning from the West to the East, underpinned by the rise of the Asian economies. The breadth and scope of these developments and their potential to create order or upheavals is enormous. the world is also experiencing a certain diffusion of power. States are being impacted more significantly by empowered individuals, groups, and non-state actors. Many of them act constructively, while some have as their objective the creation of destruction and instability. Networks and coalitions are also amassing power and affecting how global affairs are being shaped. A key game changer in the current transformation is the impact of the information and communication technology revolution, with widespread and easy access to new technology and forms of communication. Joseph Nye, who is credited with the development of the concept of soft power, referred to these two concepts of power transition and power diffusion as the big power shifts of the 21st century. The way in which states deploy power has also significantly changed, with restrictions being placed on the use of force due to economic developments and the growth of information and communication technology. In the preceding centuries, the world witnessed violence and aggression on a scale as it has never known before. Colonization, two world wars, and the threat of possible annihilation of the world through use of nuclear weapons during the Cold War led to the emergence of a broad consensus among major powers that wars have largely become delegitimized as rational policy. In particular, the horrific aftermath of the use of the atomic bomb dramatically changed the perceptions about modern war more than any single event before it. The mass destruction brought about by wars and its devastating human toll compelled major powers to explore cooperation, persuasion, and coercive means short of force to achieve their objectives. This led to the decline in the primacy of the use of hard power by nation states and the rise of the use of soft power as a tool in foreign policy. However, the stark reality is that despite these and other noble declarations, the option of using nuclear weapons remains unrenounced and integral to the doctrine of deterrence practiced by all nuclear powers, whether they are dubbed sane nuclear powers or rogue nuclear powers. Similarly, in the domain of conventional warfare, the notion of security has remained principally a weaponized concept. I am glad that your discussions touched on many ideas and indeed dilemmas that are relevant to our collective wish as to how we can progressively erode the utility of the nuclear weapon as a security dispenser, and how we can or cannot begin to de-weaponize the idea of security. While states have increasingly restricted the use of hard power on moral and ethical grounds, non-state actors continue to challenge this order by engaging in unbridled violence to achieve their ends. The rules-based international system that was evolved following the end of the two world wars and the Cold War is being continuously challenged. This has led to the rise of a global dichotomy where states are constrained in the use of hard power, with their focus being on building societies rather than empires, while non-state entities and groups are engaged in threatening this very fabric through the callous use of force and terror. Their activities have been strengthened with the weakening of state controls on borders and markets, and their inability or unwillingness to control and regulate cyberspace. In the current context, the use of military power is considered the last resort, to be used when all other avenues for cooperation and negotiation have failed. Countries will continue to invest in military power, and humans will continue to invest in weapons for purposes of self-defense. The conventional wisdom is that the buildup of military power also serves as a deterrent to its use. Although history tells us that the doctrine of deterrence has failed to prevent some wars and that it can happen again. While all of us want this century to be defined by peaceful coexistence, wars and power struggles persist, and therefore military power will remain a key role player. If we survey the state of the world today, conflict and war are almost as prevalent as oxygen. Therefore, hard power will continue to remain relevant and important. States today are seen using a mix of hard power and soft power strategies in what has come to be termed as a use of smart power to advance their strategic and security interests. Ladies and gentlemen, in analyzing the impact of soft power on global issues, there are three trends which are of significance. Firstly, the global world order is no longer bipolar. Secondly, the diffusion of power to non-state actors and the empowerment of individuals and groups is increasing their capacity to resist and thereby militating against the state's capability to compel. Finally, the development of new tools of data collection and management has given rise to digital power with the capacity to fundamentally alter the relationship between the state and the individual and influence the balance of power within and between countries. Cyberspace, or the online world, and interconnectivity across the globe has accelerated the influence of soft power in the pursuit and the definition of national interest. While all these developments have the potential to bring prosperity to a large cross-section of people across the globe, they also mean significant challenges for countries. The diffusion of power has meant that the laxity of regulatory capacity can be easily exploited by unscrupulous elements. Take, for example, the propagation of terrorist ideologies through the internet. Terrorist networks are using social media and the internet to recruit foreign terrorist fighters, often targeting vulnerable youth across the globe. The vast expanse of information available online includes data that can be used inter alia to radicalize individuals, learn how to use weapons and technology, connect with terrorist groups, and glorify acts of terrorism. It has given rise to phenomena such as the lone wolf, where self-motivated youth carry out acts of terrorism and are often not connected to major terrorist groups. These individuals are extremely difficult to detect and defend against, and this is one of the most complex and unpredictable forms of terrorism to emerge in modern times. Cyberspace remains largely ungoverned and perhaps virtually ungovernable. It is very vulnerable to attacks. Such attacks could have debilitating consequences for modern economies, which are highly dependent on the internet. While the use of cyberspace enhances a country's ability to project its soft power, it can also become a dispenser of violence, instability, and terrorism through the quick and effective propagation of extremist ideology. On the other hand, it is also a tool that can be used to even the playing field, even without economic or military might. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to also speak a little about the concept of the re-emergence of Asia's prominence and the Indian Ocean region. Asia is being reconfigured in terms of power transitions that are taking place in the waters of the Asian Oceans, the Pacific, and the Indian Ocean. A strategic security architecture based on the two oceans is being advanced, referred to as the Indo-Pacific, or more recently as the Indo-Asia-Pacific. A maritime superregion is envisaged with the Asian Oceans at its center. In a sense, this may be described as a contest, albeit a conceptual one, to exercise control over a region which will decide our common global future. Whether this is hard power, soft power, or a combination thereof, i.e. smart power at work, only time will tell. The quest for a share in Indian Ocean dominance is also emerging as an intrinsic part of this global power transition. Many countries have played a leading role in shaping order in East Asia and the Asia-Pacific, organized around a system of security alliances and political and economic partnerships. The soft power capabilities of Western powers are not diminishing. They continue to exercise tremendous soft power globally due to strong institutions, continued stability and prosperity, high per capita GDP, dominance of the English language, lead in technological matters, democratic traditions and culture, etc. Of the two Asian oceans, the Indian Ocean has surpassed the Pacific in terms of prominence. It straddles one of the world's most important sea lanes of communication and trade, and is therefore strategically important for global trade and economic development. The Indian Ocean makes up 20% of the world's water surface, and its broader territory hosts 1/3 of the world's population, 3/4 of global oil reserves, and over 70,000 ships cross its waters every year. It is estimated that around 65% of the world's oil reserves belong to just 10 of the Indian Ocean littoral states. The Indian Ocean is estimated to carry 2/3 of global oil shipments and 1/3 of bulk cargo. Most of the oil supplies to Asia from the Gulf pass through major choke points located in the Indian Ocean: the Malacca Strait, Bab el Mandeb, and the Strait of Hormuz. The region is home to the largest and increasingly rich and creative educated middle class, whose ambitions in life and purchasing power has seen exponential growth in recent times. The region's rise to prominence is also amply underscored by the emphasis placed by extra-regional powers in shaping their foreign policies with an Asia-centric approach. The build-up of military presence and capabilities of different geopolitical stakeholders in the oceans of Asia highlights the continued relevance of hard power in the global power transition that is taking place. Most countries use a mix of hard power and soft power in securing their interests in this transformative phase. Ladies and gentlemen, apart from these security interactions, several bilateral, trilateral, regional and global security structures operate that have relevance to Asia and the Indian Ocean region. These organizations and fora deal with different challenges that impact on Indian Ocean security. Several new structures for cooperation have also emerged, such as the India-Sri Lanka-Maldives Trilateral Maritime Security Cooperation Initiative and the inaugural India-Japan-US Trilateral Dialogue at ministerial level. So the strategic environment in Asia and the Indian Ocean region is indeed a complex web. All these measures touch upon the various power options you have discussed here in Colombo. Ladies and gentlemen, the term soft power is also wide enough to incorporate the efforts being made by countries to propagate their cultures and values through music, dance, cinema, intellectual discourse, and exchanges. These efforts promote understanding amongst individuals, groups, and countries, and help to build trust. I would say soft power is about getting people to understand us, to like us, to support our nation's foreign policy objectives, and promote our way of thinking and our value systems. It is also used to advance our interests in the political, diplomatic, trade, and economic fronts. Soft power tools help to maintain bilateral relations in times of tension. When formal channels of communication don't function, elements of soft power can be used to open doors for negotiations. In that sense, it exercises enormous influence on global issues. Soft power is enduring and sustainable, whereas hard power is unsustainable. Moreover, soft power is effective and efficient, whereas hard power is destructive. The human inclination, and indeed the instinct, to wield power is primordial. It is said that power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. This notwithstanding, human history is littered with sagas of use, abuse, and misuse, and the judicious use of power, and the lessons thereof learnt and unlearnt. Whether it is hard power, soft power, or smart power, the latter being the hybrid synergy drive of the former two, if one were to borrow a Toyota metaphor, the world at large and nations big or small will have their interests best served if such power is underpinned by legitimacy and democracy and executed with due respect to the force of rule rather than the rule of force. That is why a former US president famously said that democracies do not go to war with each other and that they make good trading and strategic partners. Soft power, therefore, cannot be strictly interpreted in military or non-military terms. It is with every one of us and around us. Its prudent application is what matters most. Ladies and gentlemen, limitations on hard power capabilities mean we in Sri Lanka rely to a large extent on our soft power capacities and capabilities. Located as we are at a meeting point between the East and West in the Indian Ocean, our location is of significant geostrategic importance. In a modern context, one of the most important sea lanes of communication runs just south of Dhondra Head, where close to 200 ships traverse daily, taking energy supplies to other countries in East Asia and beyond. We have responsibility for keeping these sea lanes of communication safe and ensuring the freedom of navigation. Any disturbance to the sea lane could have disastrous consequences for the global economy. The potential soft power that Sri Lanka could wield, considering our critical location in the Indian Ocean region, is yet to be fully exploited. Sri Lanka also has a long history of diplomatic engagement, characterized by a policy of friendship with all and enmity with none. Sri Lanka has continued to play considerable independence in the conduct of its foreign relations and has remained non-aligned. Ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, Sri Lanka today is a good fit for internal and external expression of soft power reality. It welcomes peaceful engagement, remains open to friendship and persuasion. It does this all while consolidating democracy, the rule of law, reconciliation, upholding, promoting, and protecting human rights, strengthening good governance, and a rule-based system. We are, in fact, enhancing the soft power of our state. Thank you very much.